Hey, my name is Matt. I want to welcome you to SCG, or Seacoast Grace Church, as we call it. Now, God's been doing some incredible things, really, over the last few years here at our church. And we've been growing, not just in attendance, but really as a church. And so, after you park your whip and you make sure it's locked, that means you'll probably end up on our courtyard. And because our church has been growing like crazy, that means tons of new people and tons of new spaces to do life together. So today, I thought I would take you around to show you what doing life at Seacoast looks like. Come follow me. So we have three weekend services, one Saturday at 5 o'clock, two Sunday morning, 9 and 10:45. Come check out what service looks like. So hang out with us for a month. You'll realize we're serious about doing life together. That's why we got a new building. It's still in progress, but we're putting it to good use. It's called the CLC, Community Life Center. Come check it out. This is our kids' ministry. And at SCG, we believe that, kids, they're our future. So we want to make sure to invest in them, all while teaching them one of the attributes that God loves most, which is humility. We believe kids, well, they're a gift. Yes, even including teenagers. However, we do understand every once in a while, they gotta be put in their place. Wow! Oh, what a feeding these kids.
We have our junior high service Tuesday nights at 7 p.m. Also, Sunday morning at 9 and 10:45 a.m. And a high school service every Wednesday at 7 p.m. as well as 10:45 every Sunday morning. We also have some awesome events your kids are gonna love.
We have so many things going on at Seacoast that really God's doing some incredible things. So I want to encourage you, come join us. Be with us at Saturday at 5 o'clock, two Sunday morning services, 9 and 10:45. We hope you enjoy your service.
Oh, swallowed up in defeat.
Can't count up.
How many raging seas opened in front of me? How many victories? How many prophecies no one would dare believe? Now it's reality.
Can't count up.
How many broken men given a second chance? See all the lifted hands.
Can't count up.
Well, good morning. Happy Easter. Christ is risen. Some of you didn't know that one, did you? Let's try it again. Christ is risen. Wonderful. That's great. We're so glad you're here. If you're a guest with us, there's a little card, and there's a QR code on there. If you would just click on that, fill it out. We have a surprise for you, a little gift. You can drop it by either, just drop it by the Welcome Center. I think they'll give you a gift there, and it's, I'm not going to say we took all the calories out. No, we added them in, actually. We put extra in there, so just in case you're wondering, we have a really special treat that someone in our congregation makes professionally, and you'll like it. So if you're a guest, stop by and get one of those. A couple things you need to know about. One, coming up in the next few weeks, we're starting a new series called You're So Close. And sometimes we quit on things in life when we're just so close. And sometimes we even quit on God when we're just so close. And so we're going to talk about how to step forward into what God has for you and becoming the person God wants you to be and you want to be. And that starts next week, so be here for that. You'll like it. So let's stand together, turn to someone and say, Christ is risen.
All right, who's ready to worship today? This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Anybody glad today? Yes.
There's a light that shines with hope and grace fills the sky. With new mercies each day we're alive. Let your glory pour out, Jesus.
There's a joy that overwhelms our souls.
We'll be right back.
risen King, the King, the name that is above every name. Come on, let's sing this out.
I wish I could tell you, wish I could describe it, but I can't contain it, can't keep it to myself. There aren't enough colors to paint the whole picture, and not enough words to ever say what I found.
Praiseworthy King, but he's also been our anchor, our protector, our defender. If he's been good to you this past season, can you just shout amen? If it's all right with you, we just want to worship how good he's been to us.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of his spirit and washed in his blood. And what he did for me on Calvary is more than enough.
Can we lift it up this morning? Let's say,
I trust, yes, my Savior, the one
never fail. Oh, I trust in God, yes, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Perfect submission. All is at rest. See, I know the author of tomorrow has ordered my steps, and we thank you for it. So this is my story, yes. This is my song.
Experience the faithfulness of God. I just encourage you to sing this with us. Let's say, I sought the Lord together.
I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord and he heard. Answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord.
Never fail.
That's why I trust.
Can we pray together? Father, there are so many reasons that gathered into this room that have watched online. There are stories that are being written at this very moment, and they all have on them similar details where we can see the fingerprints and the residue of your goodness and mercy. You are a God and King that is unmatched and unrivaled in all of creation. So we pause and halt our momentum to say, worthy is the Lamb that was slain, but that didn't stay in the grave, that got up as a testament to his power, but to show us as his creation that we are called back to life, to a life made new. And as we worship you in this place, may we be reminded of the life that we've been called to. In Jesus' name, we pray. And can someone shout amen? Amen.
Take a seat. If there's a seat next to you, could you scooch the middle? There's people out in the lobby. We would love to try to get a seat if they can. So scooch over if you've got a seat available. That'd be great. Thank you so much. All right. Well, we're here. We made it. Yeah. All right. All right. Glad that you're here. If you're visiting with us, thanks so much for being here. So we have this card. It's in the seat back in front of you. It just says a giant welcome on here, and it just has a couple lines of information. And so if you're new, we would love to meet you. You can either just fill this out, or you can use the QR code, and you can do it online real quick. And there is a shipping container that is out on the patio, and we have a special dessert that we're going to send you home with. And so here's the background story on this. At Christmas, a friend of mine who's a chef, he made this dessert, and I said, this is one of the best things I've ever had. It's like this butterscotch thing that is in a glass that's like this big. Okay, I call them Seacoast Shooters. I know I'm not supposed to, that's what we're calling them. Anyway, you can get one of those. They are amazing. And so make sure you go, you say hi, and we're not going to bug you. We're not going to use your information. We're just going to send you an email this week. Thank you for coming, and maybe give you some options of how to get plugged in here. So so thanks for being here. All right, so about 18 months ago I had this weird experience. I got out of bed. I was walking downstairs, and I started to feel a little bit dizzy. As I'm getting ready to do a workout, and then I'm going to get the kids ready for school, this dizziness turns into, and I had never experienced this before, and if you have, you know what I'm talking about, is it turned into vertigo. Now, vertigo is like, you remember those carnival rides that they spin, and you're kind of against the wall, and you can't move? That's what it feels like in real life, is the whole world is spinning out of control, and it just puts you on the ground. I couldn't even lift my head up off the ground, and my eyes are darting back and forth, and I'm then, you know, putting last night's dinner back out on the floor. And I mean, it's just a mess. And so I eke out a scream, Amy, please come help me. And so she comes down the stairs, and I am soaked in sweat. I am covered in last night's dinner, and I am a mess. And she immediately goes to call 911, and I remind her, I'm very cheap. I don't want you to call 911. In fact, I would like you to call my father. He can come, and he can help figure this out. And so my dad rushes over with my brother-in-law, and they pick me up, and they throw me in the back of the pickup truck, and they take me to the hospital. And so they start running all these tests, trying to figure out what's going on, and they kind of rule out all the major things. And eventually, at the end of the day, I'm not feeling any better, but they've ruled out I'm not dying immediately. And so it's time for me to go home. And so they send me home, and I go to see a bunch of specialists, and as they're trying to figure out what's going on, they have different theories about what the issue might be, none of which really solve the issue. And so over the coming weeks, it started to lessen and lessen until it eventually went away. Well, 6 weeks ago, I woke up, and I experienced the same thing, and I went, uh-oh, here we go. Here comes the roller coaster again. Whole thing happens again, and for the last 6 weeks, I am still dizzy. I've still experienced dizziness. Every single day I wake up, depending on how I move my head, it is just like the world is spinning out of control. I can't find anything to plant my feet with, which also makes me a bit insecure, because as a pastor, when you see me walking down the road and it looks like I'm drunk, it's not a good look for me. Now, thankfully, I've started to recover a little bit, and I'm starting to feel a little bit better, but I've realized that this feeling of uncertainty, as if the world is spinning out of control, is how a lot of people experience everyday life. Maybe not physically, but they look at the world and they just go, this is chaos. I don't even know where I can find stability in life. If you look at the last 5 years, we have had our world turned upside down, and luckily we're out of that and things are starting to get a little bit more stable. But I don't know if you have this feeling, but I'm kind of waiting for the shoe to drop, where I'm in this in-between place where I go, okay, that was crazy. When is the other crazy thing going to happen? Like, is it going to be the election, or is it going to be, something more personal at home that I'm going to have to struggle with? Is it the economy? What exactly is going to be the next shoe to drop in my life? And so we're looking for places to find stability, but if we're being honest, we've lost the trust in the places we used to find stability. All the institutions that we once put our trust in, they've kind of failed us. And so we're not really sure where to turn. If you know anything about human history, you know that we live in a very unique place and time where we've experienced a ton of comfort and prosperity. But most humans have not experienced that. Most of humanity has found the world to be a very uncertain and unstable place, And so Easter has become this moment that changes the world, and it's the most impactful event that has ever happened. Whether you're a Christian or not, you have to admit there's been nothing more important that has happened in the world. And the reason is because it starts to begin to address why the world is such a dizzying place. And so there's a guy, the Apostle Paul, and if you're familiar with the Bible, you know he wrote a big chunk of the New Testament. He was once a person who hated Christians. He actually ended up murdering Christians, and then Jesus grabs a hold of him, and he becomes a Christ follower. And so he starts writing letters to these different churches that he's helped plant, and he, in these letters, explains who Jesus is and what his life and death and resurrection meant. And he gives this great summary of what took place on Easter. Here's what he says in 1 Corinthians 15. It says this. He says, "For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance." And so he starts off, he says, look, what I'm about to tell you is not new to me. It's not original to me. It's actually something that was given to me. And scholars have learned that what he is about to repeat is an early creed. That because Christians from day one have proclaimed certain things about Jesus and his death and his resurrection, they came up with short statements that were memorable and they could pass them on. And so if you remember maybe back to a religion course that you took or maybe a video on YouTube and you were told, well, we don't really know what happened because the Bible was written way after the eyewitnesses and it was kind of like the game of telephone and it was passed on. Well, guess what? We've discovered that this creed that we're about to learn is from at least 5 years, if not sooner, than the Jesus' resurrection. And so this is like on the scene. These are people who actually saw it, and he is reporting what they said and the creed that they developed. So here's what it says. It says that Christ died for our sins. Now, the fact that there was a guy named Jesus, and he lived, and that he died on a cross, undisputed by historians, according to the scriptures. And so it wasn't like God looked at humanity and went, man, this is out of control. We have to do something to fix this. What are we going to do? All right, you're going to have to die. Let's go. No, he's had this plan from the very beginning. And he was buried. Sort of a weird detail, but remember who is hearing this. These are the people who were on the scene, who lived in the city in which Jesus was crucified and buried. In fact, we know the tomb is the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. You could go and you can visit it. In fact, some of his followers did. And so what he's saying here is go and check it out, that there really is this Jesus, and he really was crucified, and he really was buried. But what's most interesting about this is not the fact that Jesus has lived or died or that he was buried. The real interesting part is why he died. And he says it right up front, that Christ died for our sins. So as I've been going to the different doctors and trying to figure out what is going on, I've had different specialists tell me different things that they think are the issue. And I could almost deal with the spinning and dizziness if they could just tell me what the problem is. One of the most frustrating things is you can't seem to pinpoint what the real issue is here. And I think a lot of people, when they look out at the world, they see symptoms that the world is broken. And they may even have ideas of what's wrong. So here will be a really fun lunch conversation after this service for you and your family. Hopefully there's a bunch of different perspectives and points of view and worldviews, and you just throw this out there. Hey, why do you think the world's broken? And just see how it goes. Because it's going to be so fun. Your political party. No, it's your political party. No, it's education. No, it's this genetic predisposition that I fault you for. No, it's family of origin issues, which is your fault. I mean, it's going to be a blast, okay? You'll have a lot of fun if you do it. See, everybody knows that the world is not the way that it's supposed to be, and we even have theories as to what is wrong, and we come up with solutions all the time of how to fix it. So if you just look at the last 75 years in the United States, we've come up with a bunch of different potential solutions, just like my doctor. My doctor doesn't actually know what's going on, and so he gives me a bunch of potential solutions. So the last one I went to, here's what he told me. He said, I think you need to eat better, get more sleep, be less anxious, and do some physical therapy. And my response was, and you have a degree in this, right? So you think the reason I'm dizzy is because I have a dad bod. That is your conclusion here? My wife might be dizzy because of my dad bod, but I don't think it's me that's dizzy because of it. And we do this all the time. Okay, you know what? Here's what's wrong with the world. 60s and 70s said, what's wrong with the world is we are sexually repressed, and so we need to have this sexual revolution where we just have free love. Okay, no. In the 80s and 90s, the problem is economic. We need more money, more stuff, more success. Or in the 2000s, it's a lack of progress. We need more education and technology and science. And in the last few years, we've been told, no, our issues are actually political, and so we need to elect this person or this party. Or it's personal. You just need to work on yourself. You need to focus on you. Create this picture-perfect life and picture-perfect family. But at the end of it, have we actually fixed anything? I mean, sure, maybe we've made some progress, but it seems like we also have a whole new set of issues that comes along with it. If we're being honest, the brokenness is not just out there, the brokenness is in here, is we are broken. If you're a Christian or not, intuitively, you know who you're supposed to be. Like, you have these standards. Forget about the Bible, forget about the Ten Commandments, forget about all of that stuff. Let's just say, do you live up to your own standards of how you believe you should live? Like, do you look in the mirror and just go, dude, I'm perfect. I'm killing it right now. I can't believe this. No, here's how I know that you're not who you're supposed to be, is if I could create a machine that could record your thoughts for 24 hours and then we projected it on these screens, you would have zero friends left at the end of it because of the things that go through your mind and mine. As we know, fundamentally, we're broken. And we've tried to fix ourselves. We've had, we've read the self-help books, we've done therapy and yoga and mindfulness, and we've set goals, and we've created schedules and disciplines, and of course, we've made some progress along the way, but fundamentally, we're still a mess. There seems to be this new awareness, and I don't know if it's nihilistic or realistic, but people have begun to see that we can't fix ourselves. We've tried so many different ways to fix humanity, and it's not working. I read an article this week by a Harvard physicist. He talks about why he now is skipping his annual vacation, instead leading an expedition to the Pacific Ocean, where he's going to be collecting evidence from the first meteor that has come from outside of our solar system and apparently landed in the ocean. And here's what he says. Why did I sacrifice my annual vacation time on the altar of science? Because an object from interstellar space might carry a message for our salvation. I read that, I went, okay, first of all, biblical language, kind of on the nose there, but what he's saying is, and this is like a profound insight, I've come to the conclusion that humanity is so broken, we need someone far smarter and greater than us outside of our world to come into our world and to save us. I went, that's actually what the Bible has been saying for quite some time now, is you can't fix you. And so the diagnosis is this disease that the scripture calls sin. All the other things that we're talking about all need to be addressed, but those are just symptoms of what the real issue is that we have rebelled against our creator. We told God, you know what? I want to be in control. I don't want you to be in control. I'm going to do what I'm going to do. And so when we rejected our creator, we had this thing called sin that entered into the world and into the human heart, and it corrupts and it kills everything. Because the prognosis for sin is always going to be death. When you reject the author of life, you then embrace death, and it's death to everything that it touches, relational, emotional, spiritual, and of course, physical. And so until we deal with this disease called sin, we're just going to constantly addressing the symptoms. Now, as modern people, we do not like this diagnosis because we have this belief that we are good people. If I asked you right now, are you a good person or a bad person? My bet is you're going to answer, I'm a good person. And so here's the question I ask. I've used this illustration before. I used it actually this week. Let's imagine that there is this spectrum. And on one side is Jesus Christ. And then on the other side is Jeffrey Dahmer. So you have JC and JD, all right? Where are you at on this spectrum? All of you are going, Jesus. Hello, I'm with Jesus. And here's how the calculation goes, I think, for most of us, is, okay, if I do more good than bad, God's going to take all of those, and he's going to come up with, like, a percentage. All right, so as long as I do more good than bad, then I'm at least on the side of good, so then I would be on Jesus' side. And so some of us, we are just praying that we're on like the 51% good. I'm in if I could just get 51% good. Some of you guys, you're impressed with yourself. You're like, I'm like 90. I mean, I'm pretty close to Jesus, all right? Like me and him, we get confused sometimes. You know, they just don't know. Okay, so that's where we're at on the scale. Here's the problem. The problem is that the scriptures say God judges not on a percentage if you're more good than bad. It's a pass or fail. There are two categories. You are either sinless or sinful. Which one are you on? Well, okay. According to that, I don't like it, but I guess I'm on the Jeffrey side. And we're oftentimes going to look for a loophole. Okay, hold on, let's back up. I'm guilty. I'm on the sinful side, but maybe there's a category where it's like, okay, his sins are like felonies and mine are more misdemeanor sins. Yeah, and so that gets us a little bit closer to, scripture says, no. It's a pass or fail. It's an innocent or guilty. Which side are you on? And what the cross illustrates, if you've ever seen the movie Passion of Christ or you've just heard about how crucifixion takes place, is when someone is crucified, it is gruesome. It is bloody. It is shameful. It ends in death. And part of the reason why God would put Jesus on the cross is he wanted you to see, here's what sin looks like to me. It's not something that I wink at. It's not something that's like, it's no big deal. That's such and such. They do that sometimes. No, this is what it looks like. This is how I feel about sin. I'm a holy and perfect God, and this is how I feel about your rebellion. We had a speaker recently who was an atheist who eventually became a Christian, and as he was wrestling with the truth of Christianity, he said he got hung up on one question. The question was, why did Jesus have to die? Tim Keller gives a great answer to this. He says, because we are more sinful and flawed in ourselves than we ever dared believe, yet at the very same time, we are more loved and accepted in Jesus Christ than we ever dared hope. See, Jesus had to die for two reasons, one of which is because of the depth of our sin. But then there's this other reason. The other reason is because of the depth of his love. Some of us, we struggle with seeing God with both of those things. We see God and we think, okay, God is all love and he looks at me and he's just so excited about what I'm doing in the world and I'm doing well and God's happy with me. And we can't imagine God being angry at our sin. And yet there's this other part of us where sometimes we come from a specific background or worldview where we can't imagine that God actually loves us. We know we messed up. Our life and our conscience continue to remind us that we have messed up. And so what we have to be reminded about the cross is not only the sin, but the love that put him there. Let's do another thought experiment. Let's say that I have this other magical machine that I've created and it brings people from the past into the present. And so we bring a handful of people from first century Rome. And they arrive here, and after the shock of them having traveled through time, they begin to look around and start asking some questions. And one of the things that they notice is that you are wearing on your neck, a cross. And they go, whoa, why are you wearing that? Does it mean that Rome is still in power? But still, that's very strange because what that represents to us is shame and punishment and embarrassment and eventually a gruesome death. And it's very strange that you wear, it would be like us wearing an electric chair around our neck. And you go, that's not what this means anymore. It's not only around my neck, you can find it all over the entire world. And what it's come to represent is love. Love? How do you take a symbol of death and turn it into a symbol of love? Well, because of what happened on that cross. Is this man named Jesus, who is actually God in the flesh, he went to extreme lengths. In fact, he went all the way to the cross in order to reconcile us to himself. And so it is a different kind of love, a love that the world had never seen. It's almost like he showed us a new depth of love. It's this sacrificial love that we never even could imagine existed was seen on the cross. And so the reason why you see that across the entire world is because of what happened with Jesus. He showed us a whole new level of love. Just the image of Jesus on the cross breaks down barriers. It melts people's hearts. It draws people to himself because the cross is love. And so if our disease is sin, then Jesus' death is the cure. Jesus comes to earth. He lives the life that we should have lived, perfect. And yet he dies the death that we should have died so that now we can be forgiven and free. Jesus dies so we can be forgiven. So, my son, I have three kids. My youngest one, if you come here often, you've heard about him. He's like having multiple children in one. He is a lot. He's teaching me patience. About 2 weeks ago, he was out going to the store with his mom, and they pull into the parking lot, and she says, "Hey, when you get out of the door, be very careful because it's windy and we're parked next to other cars." And so he hears, "I should open this as hard as I can and as fast as I can." And so he just swings that door open and it smashes into the car next to us. So she calls me, she tells me what's going on, she waits for the guy, they, you know, swap information, and then eventually they get home from the store. And I sit him down and I go, "Okay, buddy, we need to talk about what just happened." I said, "Do you know that you messed up?" "Yeah, yeah, yeah." "Do you know this is going to cost a lot of money?" "Yeah." "You know it's going to take you like 12 years to pay this off, right?" "No, of course I didn't say that." What I said was, "Buddy, this is what happens when you don't listen to mommy and daddy. If something bad can really happen. And this is expensive, but it could have been a lot worse. And so I needed to make sure that you hear me." And so I look him in the eye. And I go, "Buddy, are you going to listen now?" "Yeah." "Are you sorry?" "Yes, daddy." "Okay, bud, go play. And then I get to pay for it." But that's exactly what happens on the cross. As Jesus comes and he looks at us eye to eye and he goes, "Did you know you messed up, right?" "Yeah, yeah, pretty bad, pretty bad." "Okay, you sorry?" "Yeah." "You're not going to do it again?" "No, I'm going to try my hardest not to." "All right, I love you. I love you too. I'll pay for it." So he frees us from all of our past sins, but then he also does this other thing where he frees us from all of our future sins. I have a friend, I know he's here because he texted me right before service. He had this video this week and I watched it and I texted him about it because he was telling the story of how he's been sober for 16 years. And he said, "You know, I tried everything. And I've had this addiction, and I went to rehab after rehab after rehab into jail, and I couldn't overcome it. It was like I was a slave to my addiction, and it wasn't until I met Jesus that I could overcome it. Because he freed me from what I was currently enslaved to." See, what Jesus does is he defeats sin, not only past sin, but future sin. He says, "Now you have the power to overcome all of those things in your life that you just simply couldn't get past." And so he comes to forgive and he comes to free. But death, of course, is only half the story because as the story continues on, it says this, "And he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures." And so we might think 2,000 years ago, "Oh, they're superstitious people. They're pretty scientific. They're not like us modern people. I'm sure they think that people can raise from the dead all the time." No, they understood death as well, if not better than we do. They saw it on a regular basis. They weren't standing at the tomb going, "Okay, 3, 2, 1, he's alive." No. They were hiding out. The disciples were going, "I hope I'm not next." And yet, something changed their mind. Not just their mind, but a bunch of people. They claim to have seen Jesus rise from the dead. And he begins to list who these people are. He says, "And he appeared to Cephas," who is Peter, "and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, he appeared to me as one abnormally born." And so what he says here is, remember who's hearing this. These are people who are living in the place and time in which Jesus was just crucified, and he announces, "Why didn't you go and ask them? Go and ask Peter." You know who Peter is. He was the guy who was just hiding and denying that he knew Jesus a couple days ago, but now he is standing up and proclaiming that he has seen the risen Lord, and he will give his life for this, and he does. Or this guy named James. You know who James is? James is the brother of Jesus. And growing up, as he was watching Jesus, he did not believe that he was the Messiah. In fact, my guess, he was kind of annoyed. He's like, "My brother has a Messiah complex. He talks about himself all the time. He thinks he's the savior of the world. It's getting a little bit old." And yet eventually he becomes a leader in the church and writes a book of the Bible. So the question for 2,000 years is, what would it take for you to believe that your sibling was the savior of the world? Rising from the dead. That's about it. That's about it. I have a sister. She's a wonderful woman. Her name is Chelsea. I will not be wearing any WWCD bracelets. I don't care what Chelsea would do. began to transform not just these people, but hundreds of others who claimed to see the risen Christ. And then it began to explode throughout the Roman Empire and eventually would take over the entire world. And so around here, we have this saying, and it's true on Easter, that Jesus changes everything. Changes everything because we no longer have to wonder if there is a God because God has now stepped into creation. We no wonder after what God is like because Jesus says, just look at me and you'll know because I am God. We no longer have to be alienated from God, but we can be reconciled to him. We no longer have to fear death because Christ has overcome it. On Easter, we don't just celebrate the fact that Jesus has risen. We celebrate the fact that we are promised to rise as well. Later on in this passage, Paul says that Jesus is the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep, meaning he is the first, but he is not the last to rise from the dead. That if we put our faith in him, that we too will rise one day, and we will spend eternity with him in this new creation. And so if this is true, that Jesus changes everything, we also say around here that it should cause us to live differently. You cannot see what happens on Easter and be indifferent. I hope you walk out of here and you have an opinion, a very strong opinion, or at least you're intrigued. And you go, I need to know if this is true. Because if it is true, it's going to change my entire world. But if it's not, I want nothing to do with this. Because you can't be indifferent about God coming to earth, dying, and resurrecting. If it is true, this should become the most important thing in our life. We should allow Jesus to take complete control, to guide, to teach, to heal, to empower us, that our whole world should revolve around this. I meet people a lot of the time who would say, I believe these things. I believe these things about Jesus and who he claimed to be in this event of the resurrection. I believe them to be true, and yet I live as if they're false. I gotta be honest, that's gotta be the worst place in the world to be. I believe it is true, and I live as if it's not. Because the scriptures say that even the demons believe that Jesus did those things. They know it's true, and yet they live as if it's not. Now, I'm not saying that you are a demon if you live that way, but I am saying it's probably pretty hellish to know the truth and live in lies. But see, we don't have to do that. We can live according to the truth, and if we do, it's going to bring an incredible amount of hope and joy, especially because we know how this story ends. About 15 years ago, my family and I were invited to a movie premiere because a friend of ours was a part of making of the movie. And so we go there, and it's a true story, and it's full of drama and suspense and action. And along the way, I'm just on this emotional roller coaster like you do in movies. And I wonder, is this guy going to make it? I mean, there's so many close calls. Is he going to survive? And then I remembered, oh, yeah, he's here at the movie premiere with us. I think he's going to be all right. I'm pretty sure I know how this ends. See, when you know Jesus, you know how the story ends. Yeah, life might be full of roller coasters and there's a lot of unknowns, but I know how the story ends. And so I can be confident, even in the midst of all the chaos, even when the world is spinning and it's making me dizzy, I can be okay. When you enter into a relationship with Jesus, you find this thing that you've been looking for, this stability in an uncertain world. Jesus says in Matthew 11:28, he says, come to me, all who are weary and burdened. And I would add here, an uncertain and a little bit dizzy. And I will give you rest. One of the things that's helped me with my physical dizziness is to find something that I can focus in on. Like an unchanging, unmoving focal point. Because that kind of brings everything into focus. See, that's what Jesus is promising to do for us. He goes, yeah, the world's going to be crazy. That sin thing that we talked about, it's making it a mess. But you don't have to live like that. If you'll just come to me, I'll take care of it. And so when I focus in on him and I'm reminded, oh yeah, he's in control. He's got this. He has a plan. I know how this story ends, and he's going to take care of me. Finds a place that I can be firm and certain in. And so Jesus' invitation, he says, is for everybody. It's not for those who are religious. It's not those who have it all together, because we know that's nobody. He says, it is for anyone who is willing to come to me and is tired of their world spinning out of control. I'll take care of it. So in a moment, we're going to just give you an opportunity. It's going to be weird. We'll just do a prayer. And if you're that kind of person who says, you know, I think I want to do, I'm tired of all this. I think I want to start following Jesus. We're going to tell you how to do that in a moment. But our team has been working for weeks now on a song, and they wrote it specifically for this weekend for this service. And so as I pray and as they get ready, I want you just to be thinking about, okay, what if this is real? What if this is something that I can build my life upon? What are the barriers that are standing in my way? Is today the day that I finally decide, okay, I need to follow this Jesus? Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for what took place on Easter. Not just that there was an incredible miracle that changes everything we know about this world, but because of what this means for us. Lord, we are far from you. Everything in us wants to cry out, no, we can fix ourselves, we're good enough, I'm sure God's impressed with us. And at the end of the day, we know fundamentally we're broken. And so, Lord, help us to just let down our guard and admit the truth about who we are and who you are. Lord, you have created a way for us to come back into a relationship with you. The only question is, are we willing to come back or not? You have come all the way to earth. You've gone to the cross. You've showed us the depth of your love. And then you wait for us to respond. And so, Lord God, I just pray that if there's anybody in this room that is feeling that calling, that they would just finally submit and say, Lord, you can have it all. In your name we pray. Amen.
There is no greater love than this. The King steps off his throne. Bear the weight of all my sin, Jesus, you alone, because you gave your life for me, a debt I could not pay. I will forever tell the world he has made a way. Hallelujah, it is finished. Don't deserve. I've been redeemed. You've set me free. I'm alive because of Christ.
Stronger.
Say that following Jesus is kind of like getting married. There's like one day that you finally say, okay, this is it. I'm entering into this relationship and it's for a lifetime. And so I enter in on this one day, and then every day after that I get up and I go and I'm still committed. Still is important. The most important thing. And so for some of us today, that might be a day, today might be the day that you say, all right, I'm ready. I'm going to follow Jesus because the world is spinning and I can't control it. And if I'm honest, my world is spinning too. And so I just need to hand it over and trust that Jesus has it. And so I'm going to pray a prayer, very simple. There's nothing magical about it. It's just a prayer of submission that you're handing over your life to Jesus. And from this day forward, you just want to follow him. And so if you'd want to do that, you can just pray along with me, pray in your mind and in your heart. And then we have one more song. Let's pray. Lord God, we have to admit that we're not just people who mess up sometimes. We're not people who can earn our forgiveness. We are people who are fundamentally broken, that we have sins. And so, Lord, we need you to save us. And that's what the cross is all about, as you have come and you have sacrificed yourself on our behalf. And so, Lord God, we want to accept that forgiveness, not because we deserve it, but because you are so good and you love us so much. And so from this day forward, Lord, our lives are now yours. Whatever you say goes, wherever you guide, we say yes. We want to become more like you, Lord Jesus. And so we commit our lives in your hands. And Lord, you promised that from this day forward, all of our past sins are forgotten and we have freedom from all of our future sins as well. And so, Lord, we want to celebrate the fact that you have overcome sin and death, which means that we have the ability to as well. Lord, we thank you. We love you. It's your name we pray. Amen. So if you did make that prayer and somebody brought you here, please tell them about it and they'll help you take some next steps of like, here's how it, you know, you can begin to follow Jesus. And of course, we want to invite you back to next week and some of our services and connect with you there as well. But we have to end Easter with a celebration, right? That's kind of the point of Easter. Oh, they're here. Okay, they're here. Why don't you guys stand with us and we're going to do one more song.
Scripture reminds us that who the Son Jesus has set free is free indeed. If you're a free person in this place, can you make some noise? Hey. Come on, let's worship together one last time. Everyone in the room, here we go. Clap your hands. That's it. Here we go. I got this revelation. It's the reason that I pray. It's a celebration, oh yeah. Every time I hear your name, I've got this revelation, oh yeah. Of all you've done for me, you set my soul on fire, and it's the reason that I can't wait.
Clap your hands, come on. Out, joy in the praise.
Yes, sir. the freedom that we have in Jesus Christ. We hope that we see you next week, but most importantly, we hope that you enjoy your Easter. We'll see you next time. Come on, say, ain't no right.